To be really quick, just want to analyze this. I'm not going to be in the comments too much. First of all, what's up, Dolphin Man? But I just wanted to get all of my quick thoughts out there because, as you can see, the Washington football team has finally come out with their first 2020 depth chart, and it's pretty telling. I mean, we already know wide receiver wise, we have Terry McLaurin and Antonio Gandy-Golden second behind him. Then you scroll down right here, you have Steven Sims in the slot, of course, Dontrell Inman as the the second outside receiver starting. Isaiah Wright is the backup slot receiver. Makes a lot of sense. What's good, Dion? That makes a lot of sense. Then you go over here to left tackle. Of course, Jerron Christian is starting. We knew that. I mean, months ago, that didn't make a lot of sense. But as of these past few weeks, we knew Jerron Christian was starting at left tackle. Sadiq Charles is the backup for left tackle. Then we have David Sharp on the roster just trying to make a name for himself. What's good, TMS? And what's good, Rich? And then, of course, you have Wes Martin starting the left guard. We brought in Joshua Garnett to compete to start the left guard. He ended up losing that battle and not making the roster. And, of course, Wes Schweitzer, who we brought over in free agency this year, is the backup. Then, of course, Chase Roullier, who's been our starting center for a little bit, is our starting center now. And Keith Ishmael, I've heard great things about him, is our backup. And it sounds like everybody between these guards and these center positions can switch between, like, Wes Martin could be a right guard or a center if we need him to be. Wes Schweitzer could be a center if we need him to be, or a right guard, as you can see. Keith Ishmael, same thing. He's the backup center, but he can play left guard or right guard from what I've heard. They've prioritized versatility. What's good, 3BYZ? What's good? What's good, Big D Money? Samuel was popping. Yes, sir. Yeah, extra. Yes, sir. Yes, sir. What's good, Mr. A? Yes, sir. My boy Taylor. Okay, and then Morgan Moses is right tackle, and Cornelius Lucas is, of course, his backup. And we'll see if Cornelius Lucas can end up winning that job over him at some point. Maybe even David Sharp could come up, but we'll see. Right now, I mean, this is Morgan Moses' first offseason being 100% healthy, so we'll see how that goes. You know what I'm saying? We'll figure it out. And then quarterback, of course, is Dwayne Haskins, and like I predicted, Kyle Allen will be second, Alex Smith is third. But Ron Rivera did say that if it were to come to it somehow, Alex Smith, he's comfortable with Alex Smith playing week one. So if it were to just, worst case scenario, Alex Smith has to play, Ron Rivera and everybody feels like Alex Smith is ready to play. Even though I've heard he's walking with a limp. What's good, Jerome? What's good? Sports fan all day. What's happening? What's happening? And then this is where it starts to get really interesting. The defense has some interesting things going on too. But the offense, running back wise, J.D. Mckissic right now is the starter, apparently. I'm not exactly sure if that matters. I mean, he may get the, you know, starting snaps, but Antonio Gibson or Peyton Barber may end up touching the ball more than him. I don't know. I'm assuming Antonio Gibson will probably end up with the most touches this game. Only reason I can see Antonio Gibson being behind J.D. Mckissic in the depth chart as of right now is because of pass blocking issues. I mean, he came in as a receiver. Oh, shouts out to my boy Jerome Smith becoming a sponsor. Hold up, we gotta forget all the analysis. What's good, man? Appreciate that, Jerome. And you went straight to Pro Bowl. So now I gotta shout you out at the end of every video I do. So much appreciated, man. Thank you, thank you, thank you a lot for that, man. Real one. Hold on. Before we move on, I gotta do the air horns. I almost left without doing the air horns for my boy, man. Appreciate that. Appreciate that. Much love, much love. But yeah, so I'm assuming that the only reason that Antonio Gibson is not first is maybe he may be a little limited just off of pass protection-wise. Maybe J.D. Mckissic, I mean, he's more of a receiver than a running back, but he's had a lot of experience at running back at the NFL level. Maybe he's a better pass blocker than Antonio Gibson as of today. I've heard Antonio Gibson has improved his pass blocking, but maybe it's not there yet, and that's why J.D. Mckissic is starting over him. But Antonio Gibson definitely has the build, 6'2", what, 220? Probably bigger than that now. Runs a 4.39. He definitely has the build, the power, to be a great pass blocking running back. I mean, he has the same legs as Saquon, and not many people in this league do. But he was more of a receiver in college, and even then he was very limited in his receiver role and running back role. So he probably just never really practiced it. He came into the NFL raw as we drafted him pass protection wise, and I'm assuming he's been getting better and better with it. I'm assuming Antonio Gibson may get the most touches. If not week one, I'm definitely by like week eight, Antonio Gibson will be the guy. But then you have Peyton Barber at the end, who a lot of people think is the guy. So we'll see. Maybe I think he's only fourth right now just because of health. It can't be. It's not because of talent. I think it's because of health. Because it's not like, unlike Reuben Foster, where he hasn't been his old self because of his past injuries. We've seen Bryce Love. Well, I've heard Ron Rivera even say that Bryce Love could be the most talented running back on this roster, and we've seen flashes of it. He just hasn't been able to stay 100% healthy yet, so that's the only reason he's this far back. But I'm more optimistic about Bryce Love than a Reuben Foster, because Bryce Love has at least shown flashes of his old self. He just hasn't been able to do it, you know, consistently with his, I'm assuming he's still kind of recovering a little bit. And then, of course, Peyton Barber will be third. If Bryce Love is not 100% healthy and trustworthy to go out there yet, Peyton Barber is automatically the third running back by default. And, I mean, he's pretty straight. You know what I'm saying? I feel like he's underrated compared to how people feel about him, especially after Adrian Peterson got cut. People were calling Peyton Barber trash and stuff. He's not trash. He's pretty solid. I had him on my fantasy team a couple of years ago, and, hey, man, he was doing his thing, so I appreciated him. All right. First of all, very interesting, it jumps off the screen. Chase Young is starting defensive end over Ryan Kerrigan. I mean, I assume that may happen, but to actually see it means a lot. So shouts out to Chase Young for winning that early. You know, Ryan Kerrigan is loved amongst the franchise. We all love him, but it's a new regime, so they have no attachment to him. They really had no reason to really go over Ryan Kerrigan over Chase Young in the first place. And it was an honest training camp battle. Chase Young seems like he won that. Then starting Daron Payne and Jonathan Allen, we've been knew that. I've been seeing in my comments and a lot of videos that Matt Ioannidis will start over Daron Payne or will start over Jonathan Allen, and I've been confused because that hasn't even been like a question. It's been like Matt Ioannidis will start, and I've been wondering like where y'all got that information from. And I mean, now it looks like I was right. Daron Payne, Jonathan Allen starting. So okay, that makes a lot of sense. But I still love Matt Ioannidis. I mean, he's extremely efficient. When he is out there, he makes the most of it. But he's our best pass rushing interior defensive lineman, but he's definitely our worst run defending at the same time. So usually Daron Payne and Jonathan Allen are going to get the most minutes. Matt Ioannidis will come out on obvious passing downs like third and long. Then Tim Settle, he will be starting another defensive line if he weren't on our team. So that's great depth right there. And then Montez Sweat, of course, won the defensive end battle on the other side. But Jack Del Rio plans on switching them around. So, like, Chase Young may be at right defensive end one play. Then he'll be at left defensive end the other play. I mean, he doesn't want an offense to be able to just game plan for him. He doesn't want one offensive line, like, one tackle to be able to, like, adjust to his game, adjust to Chase Young throughout a game. Or same thing for Montez Sweat. He wants multiple offensive linemen to be forced to block them, and he'll find which one looks the weakest against them that game and will abuse that. Ryan Anderson is the other backup defensive end. I'm surprised about that. I thought he would be more of an outside linebacker, but I've heard he's great at setting the edge and in run defense, and then his improved coverage ability against tight ends that we started to see last year, and his improved pass rush. So I thought he was like going to be the perfect Sam linebacker, but as of right now, he's the backup defensive end to Montez Sweat. And James Smith Williams made the roster over a Jordan Brelford because he's more versatile. His athletic profile means he has more potential, so I'm not surprised about that. He's also really smart too. He's like a neurophysicist or something crazy. Outside linebacker starting, my boy Sean Dion Hamilton. Yes, sir. I wanted him to start at Mike linebacker, but then when we found out that Reuben Foster wouldn't be ready day one, really, I mean, not this season at all. We have to get another look at him next season. But as of the 2020 season, after I heard Reuben Foster will be going to IR, it made the most sense that Sean Dion Hamilton would be our starting will linebacker. So shouts out to that. I predicted that. You know what I'm saying? I got that one right. John Bostic is a starting middle linebacker. From what I've heard in training camp, he hasn't been the best linebacker. He hasn't been the most explosive. Really, out of the whole linebacker group, he's the least explosive, the least athletic, the least talented. But they said he's been the most consistent. So that makes sense that he's starting at Mike linebacker. When in doubt, Sean Dion Hamilton's instincts can help John Bostic if needed. I don't think so. I think John Bostic's instincts are pretty solid. But Sean Dion Hamilton is literally the quarterback of the defense, and he's at will linebacker, so that's great. And then Kevin Pierre-Louis, I've been hearing great things about him in training camp too. I'm a little surprised that Thomas Davis isn't starting over him, but that just gives me even more, that makes me even more excited to know that Kevin Pierre-Louis went out there and earned that job, because Thomas Davis definitely had the lead on it entering training camp. So shouts out to Kevin Pierre-Louis for earning that starting outside linebacker role. More than likely the Sam linebacker on the strong side of the defense. He'll be covering more the tight ends. Sean Dion Hamilton will be covering the slot receivers, the running back side of the backfield, things like that. I've heard great things about Khalik Hudson in camp. They said he looks great. He's going to be an ace for us on special teams. For some reason, he has a knack for blocking field goals and punts. So that's just a random, like, a random joker in spades that, like, I mean, that's just so random. I don't know how you learn that. I don't know how you can teach that. But his knack for blocking punts and field goals may win us some games, may come up clutch. Cole Holcomb, love him, just needs to improve in coverage. So it makes sense that he's the backup Mike linebacker. His sideline to sideline speed is probably the best out of this entire linebacker group. So I'm expecting him eventually to probably win that Mike linebacker spot at some point in this season. And Thomas Davis Sr. is in the back end, leader of the defense as of right now. I mean, I've even seen clips in practice where Ron Rivera will, like, say one word. Thomas Davis knows exactly what it means, and he'll go tell the rest of the linebackers what they need to do on any given play or drill. So, again, I'm surprised he's not starting, but that just means Kevin Pierre-Louis must have really stepped up and earned that job. Now, the corners. I've heard Kendall Fuller, Jimmy Moreland, and Ronald Darby have been the most spectacular and the most consistent. Ronald Darby is the starting outside corner, probably will cover the number one receivers. I'm not exactly sure if Jack DeRio will have guys traveling or if they'll stay to one side of the field. If they're traveling, Ronald Darby's probably our number one corner. Kendall Fuller and Jimmy Moreland, reportedly coming out of training camp, have looked great at both outside and slot corners, so they can interchange whenever necessary. Fabian Moreau is just a backup outside corner. Greg Stroman's fifth in the depth chart, and then Danny Johnson's sixth. And they kept so many corners because Kendall Fuller's already slightly hurt. Ronald Darby has an injury history, even though he's fully healthy right now. And Fabian Moreau has an injury history. So we're not really sure if everybody can stay healthy. That's why we kept so many corners, but didn't keep that many wide receivers. That's literally why. Just injury concerns. And then starting strong safety, we already know Landon Collins and DeShazer Everett is the backup. That makes the most sense. But starting that free safety, Trey Apke beat Sean Davis so bad in the training camp battle that Sean Davis isn't even on the roster. So shouts out to Trey Apke. I haven't seen it, but I've heard great things about him. I've heard his coverage ability is improved. I've heard that he's much better at tackling angles. He's able to lay big hits on people just because he's playing faster. He forced a fumble on Logan Thomas. He forced a fumble on Logan Thomas, who's what, like 6'6"? Well over 250 pounds. He forced a fumble on him with a big hit. So Trey Apke's out here laying hits. We already knew his speed was ridiculous. He's going to usually be the fastest guy on the field any given game. So he already had the potential, but now he's got the instincts. He's got the coverage ability. He knows how to take better tackling angles. He knows how to hit hard. So some of that flash that we saw against the 49ers, I'm expecting to see that very consistently out of Trey Apke. If Jack Del Rio chooses to start you, you got to be doing something right. Jack Del Rio is one of the best defensive coordinators in the NFL. So that, I mean, I haven't seen Trey Apke with my own eyes, but from what I've heard in training camp, he looks like the starting free safety we always hope Monte Nicholson to be after his rookie season. Where, you know, we saw a little bit of Monte Nicholson. He looked like the guy of the future for us. Seems like Trey Apke picked up right where he left off in that 2017 season. And Cameron Curl, I've heard great things about him. Ron Rivera has spoken about him personally in press conferences. He's spoken highly of him. He said Cameron Curl doesn't make the same mistake twice. If he makes a mistake, expect him to correct it. You'll never see it again. And he's been all around the ball. He's been getting interception after interception. So I believe Jerron Christian led training camp in interceptions, though. But then again, he's been with the backup, so he's been picking off like Alex Smith and Kyle Allen, so he's had a little bit more of an advantage. But I believe Greg Stroman led the all DBs and interceptions in training camp, but Cameron Curl wasn't far behind. And then, oh, my fault, I went past tight end. This is also very interesting, because I already knew Logan Thomas was a starting tight end from what I've heard in training camp. He's a pretty good blocker. They say he looks very dependable in the passing game. He's able to get open slightly. If it touches his hands, he's catching it in the red zone. Him and Dwayne Haskins have built up a rapport. Him and Dwayne Haskins in the red zone is pretty much automatic touchdown, which is huge for us. That's something we haven't had in years, a dependable red zone target. So not only did we add Dontrell Inman at receiver, but we have Logan Thomas at tight end to also help Dwayne Haskins red zone target wise. And, you know, third and short, third and three, we want to pass the ball. Logan Thomas is a dependable target, him and Dontrell Inman. Then what surprised me is that not only Jeremy Sprinkle making the roster, I thought Hale Hinges would make it over him just off of the fact that Hale Hinges is a better fullback, but now Jeremy Sprinkle is second in the depth chart as far as tight ends go. I heard great things about Marcus Ball. They say he's the most athletic tight end out of everybody we had at training camp. So receiving wise, it sounds like he's pretty dominant, but I'm assuming he has to improve on his blocking or something like that. And that's why Jeremy Sprinkle is over him. Again, I'm surprised Jeremy Sprinkle even made the roster. Now he's second up. I thought it was Logan Thomas and Marcus Ball that were, you know, if we run 12 personnel, one running back, two tight ends, I thought it was going to be Logan Thomas and Marcus Ball, but it sounds like it might be Jeremy Sprinkle. And, I mean, I'm assuming Jeremy Sprinkle, just off of being somewhat of a veteran. He's tall, too. I think he's one of the taller guys out of the tight end group, so I guess that makes sense. But, yeah, and then, of course, special teams, Tressway, Dustin Hopkins, and then Nick Sundberg. And then, oh, very interesting. This is my first time seeing this. I didn't even see this before I started the live stream. Steven Sims Jr. is our starting kick returner and punt returner. It makes a lot of sense. And then Isaiah Wright is right behind him. I guess that. I thought Isaiah Wright would start over Steven Sims, with Steven Sims, you know, taking over full slot receiver responsibilities. But I guess he's the type of guy that they want to get him started. They want to get him touches in special teams. So when they get him touches in the offense, you know, he's already warmed up, his legs are churning, and he'll be able to do a lot after the catch like he did last year for us. So I'm assuming that's probably why Steven Sims is starting in special teams as a returner. I mean, and he's really deadly too. We've seen what he did against the Patriots. We've seen what he's done against several teams. What he does once the ball is in his hands is phenomenal. That's why I think he has a lot more potential than I like Jamison Crowder a lot, but he couldn't stay healthy. And Steven Sims is far more athletic than him, far more shifty. So I feel like we have our slot receiver of the future and our returner of the future between him and Isaiah Wright. I'm not surprised Antonio Gibson is in on kick returns, especially until he takes over a full running back role and they want to limit how many times he gets hit. Until then, it makes a lot of sense for him to be one of the main kick returners because he is very electric with the ball in his hands. Again, he has the legs of Saquon, the body of an Alvin Kamara, the speed of Christian McCaffrey ran a 4.49, Antonio Gibson ran a 4.39. And Antonio Gibson is 6'2", well over 220 pounds. So that should tell you everything about his physical profile that you need to know. And his vision is ridiculous, even with the limited amount of snaps at running back he got in college. You see traces of great vision. So I'm expecting him to be a deadly returner for us. I feel like Isaiah Wright at some point may take over complete kick return and punt return responsibilities at some point. But until then, they know Steven Sims can handle it. They know he won't muff the punts and kickoffs and stuff like that. And Antonio Gibson is electric. And then I guess Danny Johnson, so he can have more of an impact on the team and have a more predominant role. I mean, a bigger role in the team. They have him also in kick returns as like a backup, I guess. I mean, especially since we don't expect him to play at corner. If Danny Johnson's playing at corner for us in a regular season game, we're in trouble. So hopefully he doesn't play any corner for us, and that's why they have him at least having somewhat of an impact on the team in special teams as a returner. So that makes a lot of sense. So yeah, man, this is crazy. I think the biggest surprise for me is J.D. Mckissic as a starting running back. I'm going to get to the comments for a little while, but I do want to end this stream soon. I don't want it to last too long. Y'all heard about Odell? Yeah, I saw the Odell thing. I don't know. Yeah, Beast Mode said we're on fire on paper. Yes, sir. What's good, LC? Yeah, man. I think we look great. I think we look great on paper. I'm really excited, man. Shouts out to everybody subscribing, too, man. Much appreciated. What's up, OKG2000? What's good, everybody? Casper Hill, what's good? I'm about to dip up out of here. I'm so mad at the predictions. Yeah, bro. A lot of us are really off, man. A lot of us are really off. I'm not going to lie. But again, I just wanted this to be a quick video. I'm going to end it at a solid 20 minutes, so a minute 20 seconds will end this. But yeah, I just want to get some of y'all feedback on a lot of this. Again, for me, Jeremy Sprinkle number 2, one of the biggest surprises. J.D. Mckissic number 1. I thought he would be possibly even 3rd. I thought it was going to be Antonio Gibson, Bryce Love, then J.D. Mckissic. That man's all the way at number 1. But again, I strongly feel like it's because of pass protection. I mean, of course it's because of versatility, but Antonio Gibson is a freakier athlete than J.D. Mckissic. So I'm assuming J.D. Mckissic is getting that starting role in the depth chart. He may not get the most touches week 1, but like as far as like maybe the first snap of the game, I feel like it's just because of his pass protection ability. Let me see any more surprises I can think of. I mean, we already knew Jerron Christian. We already knew Sadiq Charles backup. Linebacker room. I'm not surprised about Shondell Hamilton starting. I'm not surprised about John Bostic. But the fact that Kevin Pierre-Louis beat out Thomas Davis speaks highly of how good he looks in camp. Again, I'm confused as to why people thought Matt Ioannidis would start suddenly. I'm still confused. People were saying it like convincingly in my comments on my videos. I'm looking around like maybe I'm tripping. I got the little Mr. Krabs meme with the dizzy room at the desk. I was like maybe I'm bugging. Where's McLaurin? Oh, we already know McLaurin starting wide receiver. That's, again, I'm only talking about the surprises. The surprises of Jeremy Sprinkle, number two. I knew Kyle Allen would be starting over Alex Smith if, like, when in doubt, if Dwayne Haskins had to lead the game for any reason. Please knock on wood, man. Please don't let that happen for any reason. Chase Young winning the job over Ryan Kerrigan. I assumed he would, but it's still nice to hear that. I'm a little surprised Ryan Anderson is at defensive end instead of outside linebacker, especially as much as he improved last year. But so far in training camp, the only reason I'm not surprised is because so far in training camp, he's been working with the edge rushers more than he's been working with the linebackers anyway. The only time he really did linebacker work was 7-on-7 drills. And again, Kevin Pierre-Louis starting over Thomas Davis is big time news. Cameron Curl making the roster over Sean Davis. That's great to hear. Young talent that we're going to cultivate, develop on our own, homegrown talent, drafted late in the round. Shouts out Kyle Smith for getting so many guys late in the round, so many impact players for cheap and free agency. Ron Rivera and Kyle Smith did their thing in the draft and free agency. And Kyle Smith been doing his thing in the draft for us. So shouts out to him. I mean, Keith Ishmael, backup center, drafted in the fifth round. Chase Roulier, starting center, drafted in the fifth round. I mean, come on now. Our personnel, people making decisions in the draft, scouts, who we're gonna pick up in free agency, been doing their thing. And again, Kevin Pierre-Louis starting over Thomas Davis. That's great news for us. Thanks, Rico. It's good stuff, man. Appreciate that whiskey. Oh, dang. Time went by that fast. I was trying to end it at 20. Bro, imagine being an O-lineman and finally getting a break from Chase just to see Kerrigan line up in front of you. Bro, I'm telling you. And even then, Chase Young and Montez Sweat are going to flip back and forth throughout a game. So even without Ryan Kerrigan and Ryan Anderson and James Smith Williams entering the game, you're a right tackle. You're dealing with Montez Sweat for like a quarter. Out of nowhere, here comes Chase Young the next quarter. Or you're dealing with Montez Sweat first and second down. Now you got to deal with Chase Young on third down. And then the next series, you got to deal with Ryan Kerrigan on first down or something. I mean, it's just, bro, it's sad. It's quite scary. I really feel sorry for the Eagles. And it's crazy, too. I was working on my Washington football team versus the Eagles preview. I'm going to break down stats and our matchup history, you know, throughout just all of NFL time, all of that. And like who's been winning the series between us throughout history. I'm breaking down like rankings, like points allowed on defense, points scored on offense, penalties, turnover differentials and stuff like that. Just breaking down how we looked in 2019 and then also breaking down how we should look in 2020 and who should win the game. I was literally working on that, got a notification about the depth chart, and that's how I got here. So expect that video to come out today at some point. Our 5-2 would be a problem. We need to run that. It's a good point, Rich. Goosebump. What's good, Carol? What's good? Carell, what's good? Yeah, man. Hey, man, I feel sorry for any tackle that has to deal with Chase Young any given play, Montez Sweat any given play. Here come Ryan Kerrigan and Ryan Anderson right off the bench, man. Oh, man. And y'all can't forget, Ryan Anderson was tied in the league for forced fumbles last season, and he only started a handful of games, the games that Ryan Kerrigan got hurt. So remember that Ryan Anderson is basically the Matt Ioannidis out of the edge rushers. Like, he doesn't play a lot, but when he does, he makes the most of it. Remember, he tied the entire NFL in forced fumbles, and he only started like a couple of games. So before he got hurt and he got ejected one game or something like that. So don't sleep on Ryan Anderson pass rush wise. He finally looks like that second round pick that we chose him with. Appreciate that, Thomas. Appreciate everybody. So yeah, I'm gonna go ahead and dip up out of here. This is supposed to be like a quick 15 minutes, 20 minutes. Y'all already know I go later than that. I'm about to get right back to working on my Washington football team versus the Eagles preview video. Y'all gonna get that at some point today. Also, be on the lookout for a random, I'm just gonna randomly live stream to fill up those last four slots in my fantasy league with the subscribers. So make sure you're ready. I'm just gonna randomly just live stream. It might be at 4:52 p.m. Just random live stream. I'm not even going to schedule. I'm just going to live stream, see who wants to fill up those last four slots for fantasy. I appreciate everybody that pulled up. I'll catch y'all later.